Jack Antonoff is the de facto king of pop. He's never lived his life particularly in the spotlight as compared to many of the people he's worked with, but it's undeniable that his influence has seeped into a tremendous range of modern music. In today's video, we're going to explore what made Antonoff so successful as a musician and producer, examine his streak of incredible albums, and also question what his future in the music world will look like. Before the video starts, my name is Felix, and if you enjoy this video, be sure to give it a like and subscribe. Now, let's talk about Jack Antonoff. The beginnings of a career. It seems like everybody knows Antonoff for different reasons, and perhaps that just shows how multi-talented he is, and points to the fact that his career has had strong longevity. Antonoff was born in 1984 in the town of Bergenfield, New Jersey, opposite of New York City. In high school, Antonoff toured as a punk band musician. While his first gig was not very successful, it did pave his love for music and understanding for the industry. Antonoff attended the esteemed Professional Children's School in NYC, a place where many future theater, music, and film stars all graduated from. After many years of playing gigs in bands with friends and experimenting with music, Antonoff finally hit his first big break. The fun years. At the age of 24, along with fellow musicians Nate Roos and Andrew Dost, Antonoff helped found the band Fun. Their debut album, Aim and Ignite, released in 2009 and was critically successful, and while it performed fairly well for a new band, the album and band weren't exactly mainstream yet. However, this fame would come in the form of Fun's sophomore album, Some Nights. This album, which peaked at third on the Billboard 200 charts, spawned hits like the titular Some Nights, Carry On, and of course the number one charting anthemic We Are Young. While Some Nights didn't perform critically as well as its predecessor, its popularity boosted Fun into the national spotlight. While Nate Roos, the lead singer, was perhaps the face of the band, and rightfully so, it was Antonoff who was one of the main men behind the pen. Antonoff, who played lead guitar, drums, and piano for the band, also played a crucial role in composition, production, and lyricism. For a while, it appeared that Fun would be at the top of the pop world. They combined a radio-friendly song type with deep, witty, and emotional lyrics while incorporating sounds from hip-hop, rock, and pop. They were nominated for 6 Grammy Awards, taking home the prize for Best New Artist, and impressively, Song of the Year with a hit, We Are Young. The band even had the opportunity to play with their legendary idols, Queen, in 2013, and it seemed like everything was going right for the boys. But as can happen with bands and newfound success, tensions rose and egos became present. While Fun didn't necessarily have a messy public breakup as a band, they did enter a hiatus after releasing a free EP in 2013, which to date is their last work together. So, it was off to solo projects for Roos, Dost, and of course, Antonoff. All three musicians ventured into their own paths. Roos released his own music, Dost took part in some scores before generally slowing down his career, and Antonoff's next move was to create a new project known as Bleachers. Bleachers' music is heavily inspired by Bruce Springsteen, and incorporates an indie pop sound with complex lyrics. This project of Antonoff's is still continuing and thriving, with a third album recently released to relative success and decent critical acclaim. Bleachers isn't any type of groundbreaking music from Antonoff, but it is an enjoyable project with some good songs. Production and songwriting success. Antonoff's career after 5 years with the band Fun isn't currently characterized by his own Bleachers project, but instead with the work that he's done with high-profile artists. Antonoff had long been friends with Taylor Swift. Both had risen to fame in their respective careers at relatively similar times, and certainly had been able to interact and brainstorm several times before their first official collaboration. Swift invited Antonoff to help work on her 2013 pop album, known as 1989, a marked change for the country star to move towards a new genre. Antonoff helped to write and produce 3 tracks on the record, including work on lyrics, guitar lines, and drums. Antonoff's work with Swift certainly led him to being recognized as a legitimate music producer and songwriter within the industry. This brought him to his next gig, working as the primary producer and co-writer on Lorde's 2017 album Melodrama. This is one of my personal favorite pop albums of all time, and in my opinion, some of Antonoff and Lorde's finest work. Lorde obviously found breakthrough success as a New Zealand teenager through 2013's Pure Erowine, and was looking to continue her upward trajectory. On Melodrama, Antonoff adopts a maximalist production style on tracks like the opener Green Light. While also showing his capability on ballads like Liability and Writer in the Dark. Melodrama was extremely successful both critically and commercially, topping the US charts as a number one album, while bringing more recognition to Lorde, but perhaps more notably Antonoff. This was the first album where he had been the main producer and man behind the songs, and it was an extremely good project at that that boosted him to fame. Bouncing off his newfound success, Antonoff became a hot commodity for production, songwriting, and instrumental work. He returned to Swift to play an even bigger role in her album Reputation, this time handling production and writing duties on 5 songs. Later in 2017, he produced Annie Clark, or better known by her stage name St. Vincent's, album Mass Seduction. It was another critically acclaimed album and showed Antonoff's versatility as a producer and musician. Whereas Melodrama was more of a glamorous yet mainstream album, Antonoff was able to complement and tailor his sound to match Clark's more rock and experimental groove. Songs like the title track showed a different side of what Antonoff was capable of creating. But as much as this video is about Antonoff, I don't want to diminish from the work of the artists who are releasing these albums. The artists that we've already talked about, Swift, Lorde, and St. Vincent, are all extremely talented songwriters, musicians, and singers in their own right, and while Antonoff was able to enhance their final product through his own musicianship, it's impossible to believe that these albums would have been so good had it not been for the actual talent of the women themselves. Soon enough, Antonoff was back in the studio for Swift's 7th album, Lover, where he once again increased his responsibilities. This time, he was handed the pen to write on 8 songs and given the keys to produce 11 of the tracks, marking the first time that he was the primary producer and co-songwriter on one of Swift's albums. The last 3 albums that we've discussed show Antonoff's unique abilities: a maximalist breakup pop record in Lorde, a record that perhaps does more sound experimentation and cultural observation in St. Vincent, and then a more traditional, albeit still boundary-pushing, Love album for Swift. The natural progression for Antonoff was, of course, to delve into new sounds. This new direction didn't take long for Antonoff to find, as he produced the album Arizona Baby for Kevin Abstract, the lead man for hip-hop collective Brockhampton. An R&B and rap album, Antonoff showed that he wasn't afraid to tackle different genres and beats, as we've already observed. Arizona Baby isn't groundbreaking work for anybody, but it's another solid project on Antonoff's resume. The next project that he would have his hands on, however, would be something special. 2019 marked the release of Lana Del Rey's Norman Rockwell, another album that Antonoff had tremendous writing and production responsibilities on. This album marked another change in sound, a larger focus on guitar and piano-driven melodies, something that perfectly encapsulated nostalgia, or the feeling of Americana. Instead of having me describe it, here's a listen into one of the tracks that Antonoff penned, Mariner's Apartment Complex. The album, which I'll abbreviate to NFR, was another critical commercial crossover, landing at number 3 on the Billboard 200 albums chart for sales. Critics largely lauded Lana Del Rey for improved songwriting, which I think Antonoff deserves some amount of credit for, as he was the primary co-writer for the album. Once again, all roads led Antonoff back to Taylor Swift. 2020's Folklore is generally considered Swift's strongest front-to-back album, and Antonoff helped produce 6 songs and write 4 others. But while Antonoff did play a very important role on the album, he shared production and writing duties with fellow producer Aaron Dessner, whereas he had the primary control on Swift's previous project, A Slight Fall from Grace. Antonoff was really at the top of his reputation after the release of Folklore. It seemed that a great number of popular artists wanted him to help with writing, production, and instrumentation on their own records. While perhaps not all of the records he worked on hit perfect commercial or critical success, there's not a single album that I've talked about that you can objectively say is bad. Most of all, I'd argue that all are really, really good works of art that prove that pop music wasn't just one flavor, and instead could branch out into a variety of genres and motifs. But it's at this point that I also believe that the quality of Antonoff's music started to decline. 2021 has been a really busy year for Antonoff, seeing four albums where he has been the primary producer, along with Swift's Fearless re-release album that he played an important role in. That's not to mention the release of his own band, Bleachers, that has also taken place this year, and a lot has been going on in his personal life as well. As of writing this script, there are still 4 months to go in the year, and Antonoff has done, in my opinion, just too much. The St. Vincent and Claro releases have been fairly solid. St. Vincent albums are never too much of a letdown, and this release, Daddy's Home, was no exception. But I also believe that this is because Annie Clark is one of the strongest and most imaginative musicians in her own right, and she doesn't necessarily need Antonoff's musicianship to guide her albums. The two Antonoff-produced St. Vincent albums have been more fun and sonically experimenting than I think have been a primary focus for Antonoff. The Claro record, Sling, isn't bad by any stretch of the imagination, but I believe that barring drastic sound or songwriting changes, Claro is kind of limited by her ability. The two real big letdowns of the year are Lana Del Rey's Chemtrails Over the Country Club and Lorde's Solar Power, which in part inspired this video. Chemtrails isn't a bad album. Like I kind of poked around earlier, I don't think that talented artists like Del Rey, Lorde, and Antonoff are capable of making bad albums simply because of their talents and reputations. But what they can do is make slightly boring albums. Both Chemtrails and Solar Power have their own highlights and good songs, but they're just not there as a cohesive project. Perhaps the biggest problem is simply that their predecessors were some of the best pop records of the last decade. But that's no excuse, and if you listen to, for example, NFR and Chemtrails back to back, I think it's pretty clear which is the better record. NFR is the type of album where you might not skip a single track. It has fun taking some risks and overall has really solid songwriting. To me, the writing on Chemtrails, while not bad, doesn't stack up to NFR. The sound isn't quite as nostalgic and is more folky, if anything. I still like the album, but it's just not something that I want to hear on repeat. The issue is even more apparent on Lorde's side of things. I adore Lorde. I think she's a phenomenal artist and I'll support her regardless of the direction that she chooses to take her music. And I think her latest album, Solar Power, had the bones of a really good project, but Antonoff simply couldn't help execute on these ideas. Tracks don't necessarily distinguish themselves from one another. Instrumentation is just too similar and a bit boring at times, and even a little bit similar to Del Rey's project. I personally feel like the songwriting quality has dropped slightly too. Of course, you're entitled to your own opinion, and I recommend that you give all these albums a listen in comparison. And when it comes to comparing Lorde's last two albums, it's like apples and oranges because they intentionally aim for different styles. But when we look at the critical reviews, it seems like a good amount of people agree with me. Since Lana has a larger sample size, we'll compare her last four albums just to see. 2015's Honeymoon and 2017's Lust for Life both came without Antonoff's production. Using the aggregate scorer website Album of the Year, where critics are officially recognized publications and users are just internet music listeners, you can see that both albums were well reviewed by critics and users, but not exceptional by any standards. NFR takes a sudden and dramatic leap upwards, and this is when Antonoff took over production and co-writing duties. I believe that it's a brilliant record, and it seems like others agree. Next up is Chemtrails, which has good reviews, but once again isn't exceptional according to critics and users on this particular website. Now we'll move over to Lorde's music. She debuted at 16 years old with Pure Erlewine, which is a really solid first album, especially at such a young age. Then comes Melodrama, which is where Antonoff comes in for Lorde. I absolutely love this record, and it seems like people also think that. Solar Power's reviews show a marked decrease from their two counterparts. A bad album? No, not necessarily. But scores indicate for a more average and unspectacular effort. Yes, a small sample size of bitter music critics and random online nerds isn't scientific, but it does give a general consensus. Once again, to each your own opinion, don't just listen to mine or these people online. But a bigger problem than these albums themselves is Antonoff's production seems to be getting more boring and even repetitive at stages. Many people found similarities between Lorde's Stoned at the Nail Salon and Lana Del Rey's Wild at Heart, both songs from their latest projects. Take a listen for yourself. Maybe I just stoned at the nail salon. If you love me, you love me, cause I'm wild at heart. Even if you don't think the two songs sound too similar, there's no denying Antonoff has been approaching many songs with similar chord progressions, and in general, his music has been sounding more similar and, in my opinion, bland. To me, the sound that Antonoff has approached has taken a turn more towards indie folk. There's nothing wrong with that, but it does become problematic where it seems like every album that you're helping produce takes that same exact sound approach. The future. Just a few years ago, a new Jack Antonoff produced or co-written project was something to really look forward to. It was fair to expect extremely strong songwriting and unique and fresh production styles. Now I get a little bit nervous before one of the projects that he's worked on. Is it going to live up to the expectations? Is it going to be a meaningful album to listen to? What new musical ideas are going to be explored and brought to the plate? Look, I'm not qualified at all to give musical advice. My production knowledge is very much limited, and so is my understanding of theory. But I think that what Antonoff needs to do is take less responsibilities and work on less projects. Just as when it comes to writing books, scripts, or stories, you can face writer's block in music too. Sometimes writing more might inspire new ideas, but in other scenarios, you just need to take a step back where you'll eventually be re-inspired to create new sounds and explore different ideas. I feel like I've heard the melancholic, nostalgic indie folk album a dozen times before. That doesn't automatically mean that such an album is going to be bad, but it does mean that it needs to do so much more to differentiate itself from the others. The interesting thing is where in other scenarios it might represent a greater shift in all of music, it appears to me that Antonoff himself is at the forefront of this new sound. I still have faith that Antonoff has solid musical production chops, but I don't believe that he's in that state of mind right now. I would rather have one or two great and memorable albums as opposed to five or six good but unspectacular efforts. Part of this might also necessitate working with new artists in different genres. As Antonoff has shown, he has the ability to dabble in different genres such as hip-hop, synth-pop, and so much more. I think that getting out of his comfort zone would improve the quality of music that he's giving to us as well. Overall, I have tremendous respect for Jack Antonoff and the work that he does. It's not easy to make art that millions of people are going to digest, and I would certainly crack under the pressure. It's even more impressive when you look at the trajectory of his career and the ups and downs that he's faced. It appears that he's found his niche as one of the world's most well-regarded and recognized music producers of our age. I just believe that he's given us a glimpse of brilliance that he has yet to fully show to the world. The next few years will be critical in determining the longevity and legacy of Antonoff's music. Will he become an all-time producer that pushes the bill sonically, or will he just be one of the dozens of pop producers who make music based off the times? Thank you so much for watching this video. As I've prefaced before, everything that I've presented has been just my personal opinion and could be heated as we're discussing people that we all have tremendous respect for. I'd love to hear your own opinion in the comments. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to like and subscribe, and until next time, have a great day.